Hi, I'm Berks County Commissioner Dante Santoni, and welcome to this month's edition of County Connections. Thanks for joining us. Well, spring is in the air, and with that, of course, we're going to have nicer weather, warmer weather. Thank goodness for that. The flowers are starting to bloom, and baseball is in the air. We all love baseball, and we have a great minor league team here in Reading, the Reading Fightin Phils. So we're going to talk on today's edition of County Connections about the Reading Phils, the upcoming season, with some people that work down at the stadium. Joining me today, very honored to have them here, is Sheila Contento. Sheila is the executive director of the Redner's Event Center at the stadium. She's going to talk about her job, a little bit about her background maybe, and some of the great events that are occurring this spring and summer and early fall at the stadium. With her is Jake Starr. Jake, welcome as well. Jake's the public relations manager for the Fightin Phils and also the broadcaster. He's in his second year, I understand. So we'll learn a little bit about what Jake does. And again, a lot of the things that are going to be happening, exciting things happening down at the stadium. Sheila, why don't we start with you? I know, as I said, you're the executive director of the Redner's Event Center, which is something new down at the stadium, and I don't think it's open yet, but maybe tell a little bit about, first of all, what you do and a little bit about your background, where you came from. I know that you have some background with the organization at the minor league level, so why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, sure. So I actually started with the Reading Phillies back in 2007. I interned there following college, and then I made my return to minor league baseball November 1st of this year to help organize the opening of the Redner's Event Center, which is slated for June 1st. Yeah. So right now the lower level of the building is up and running, and it's actually the new player facilities. So the clubhouse has been relocated to the first floor of the building, along with a brand new dining hall, weight room, training room, state-of-the-art facilities for the team that just came up from Clearwater. So they're super excited. We're happy to be able to accommodate them in that capacity. And as of June 1st, we will have a brand new event center to offer the area as well, which will be available both on game days as well as non-game days. And that will really catapult the ballpark into being a year-round facility, whether it's for corporate meetings, corporate events, game day outings, weddings, proms, fundraisers. So we're super excited to be able to kind of take the ballpark in a new direction.
Great. And I know you said you're with the Phillies, and there's a lot of excitement. Some of the events you mentioned, I mean, they're all going to not just be baseball related. There's going to be some other things as well. Is that correct?
That's correct. So June 1st is actually our official opening day for the facility, and we do have a high school reunion is the first event that's being booked, and then I believe June 4th will be the first game that we'll be able to utilize the space on a game day capacity. But we have had a lot of interest with regards to, we have already had some corporate meetings that have booked, we have a tentative wedding on the books, some prom inquiries, and we actually have a trade show that is on the books for 2025. So we have both some immediate business that's kind of making its way into the ballpark facilities, as well as some long-term bookings, which we're really excited about.
So when the season starts, you said that there's going to be a lot of corporate event, there are corporate community involved in renting the facility,
yes,
in conjunction with the game, and how could they go about getting the information on that?
So if you go to the Reading Phillies website, there is an inquiry form that they can fill out, and then that would put them in touch with either myself or one of my associates to go into the details of booking. We actually have set up the facility so that we have 8 different catering partners, all of which are local to Berks County, which is great in that it really sets the stage for us to work with a wide array of groups and organizations with a varying budget and price points that they're looking to adhere to. All 8 are local to the county and are names that are recognizable as well. So we're super excited to have those as partners to the Redner's Event Center.
That's great. Well, we look forward to that, and we'll chat a little bit more about that. But let's go over and talk to Jake for a little bit. I know, Jake, you are the public relations manager and broadcaster for the Fightins. So why don't you tell a little bit about your background and what brought you to Reading?
Yeah, so I graduated from Penn State in 2022. Was a member of their journalism school, ran the radio station up there, had some internship with some collegiate summer leagues leading up to graduation from college, and got really fortunate coming out of college where a position was opened up with Reading, kind of just reached out and was brought on in January of 2023 as kind of like a full-time intern. So did that throughout the 2023 season. Was lucky enough to be hired full-time once the season came to an end, and entering, you know, season number two in 2024, and just super excited about it.
Well, I appreciate that. Let's talk a little bit about the team. I know that you're, as you said, this is your second year broadcasting, so you get an opportunity to learn about the players. What are some exciting things we should know about this year's Fightins?
Yeah, it's an interesting group. It's really a mix of experience with a lot of younger guys. It's an older team at the AA level. I think our average age is a little under 25, which is considerably old for a AA team. You know, usually teams that old are more AAA. And I kind of said throughout the offseason, well, leading up to the season, was that this is a group that has a lot of guys that probably could be in AAA in a lot of organizations, but the Phillies are just really deep. You know, there's a lot of guys on Lehigh Valley's roster that probably could be on a lot of major league rosters right now. Credit to the Phillies for building that depth. But the result of that is that a lot of those older guys kind of get bumped down to AA. So we have a lot of older guys, experienced guys, which I think is really beneficial to have with this group. And then also, there's a lot of younger guys, too. We have four of the Phillies' top 30 prospects, Gabriel Rincones Jr., Carlos De La Cruz, Caleb Ricketts, and Robert Moore. So exciting group. Our pitching staff is, our starting staff's on the older side. Our bullpen does feature some younger arms, some exciting arms too, some guys that can throw upper 90s, maybe touch 100. So it should be an interesting group. I know our manager said that it's going to be a team that's going to hit a lot of home runs, might also strike out a lot, but that's also just the nature of the game nowadays too. But should be a pretty solid group overall.
Look forward to that. Let's talk about some of the scheduling things and some of the exciting games coming up. There's a little change in the schedule. You said we talked earlier about how they do the schedule this year where they play a certain amount of team for the whole week. So why don't you just chat a little bit about that?
Yeah, so minor league baseball before COVID, it used to be pretty similar to major league baseball where it was 3- and 4-game series. You'd be going city to city every few days. And when COVID hit, I think to try and limit the amount of times the teams were traveling and in different cities, they went to the 6-game series. So teams would play Tuesday through Sunday, and there'd be a universal minor league baseball off day on Monday. And I think teams really came to like that 6-game, 6-on, 1-off schedule format that they ended up sticking with. And there's been a couple of exceptions, you know, start of the season, coming out of the All-Star break, some Friday, Saturday, Sunday, 3-game series. But outside of that, it's pretty much Tuesday through Sunday and the one-off day. And I think the teams like that. Once you get to a city on Tuesday, you're there through Sunday. You can kind of get yourself into more of a routine as opposed to jumping city to city every 3 or 4 days.
Okay. I guess that helps with the travel, yeah. Let's talk about how the breakdown is in the Eastern League. I know the Fightins have been around for a long, long time, of course. What are some of the other teams? Maybe is there a new team, a couple new teams in the league this year, and how the divisions break out?
Yeah, so pretty historically, the league has kind of stayed pretty consistent for the last handful of years. We're in the Northeast Division, so we're joined with teams Portland, who we played in our season-opening homestand at home, Hartford, New Hampshire, Binghamton, and Somerset join us in the Northeast Division. And then the Southwest Division, we'll see Bowie, who we saw to open up our season on the road last weekend. We'll see Richmond, Erie, Akron, Altoona, and Harrisburg. So a pretty good breakup, you know, as far north as Portland, as far south as Richmond, and as far west as Akron, Ohio.
And you travel with the team whenever you're going, whenever they're on the road?
We get to go on a few road trips.
Okay.
I was in Bowie, I know, last weekend. I'll make a couple more throughout the season as well.
Good. Sheila, let's talk about, I know that minor league is changing and there's some requirements coming down from the big leagues, and I guess that's another big reason why they built the Redner Center, because there's certain requirements that the minor leagues had to provide, et cetera. Could you maybe talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, so one of the reasons this project came about with regards to establishing the Redner's Event Center was to meet major league requirements in order to keep the team in Reading. So we not only kind of check the boxes of establishing kind of those league requirements, but through the help of a number of different avenues, we actually went well above and beyond what was required. So the new event center is leaps and bounds above what you would find at other minor league stadiums throughout the country, not only from a player development perspective, but also from the event side of things.
Okay.
The primary space that we're going to have is sits actually above the clubhouse, which is our large event center, and it's just about 6,400 square feet. In the off season, we'll actually have the ability to take over the clubhouses, as well as the turf club, which is our new batting tunnel. That's actually under construction still, so wouldn't be available for us to utilize until about September. And of course, the clubhouses we can't use until we're in the off season, which would again fall to September. But all four of those spaces now give us the ability to have 14,000 plus square feet of flexible meeting space that really kind of changes the name of the game for us in baseball town.
And it's out, you said it's out beyond center field, correct?
That's correct. Yeah. You can't miss it.
I don't know if either of you can talk. I know that that's not the only exciting thing happening at the stadium. We have other facilities, the pool, the picnic area. Can anybody talk about a little bit about any of those facilities? I don't know if Jake or Sheila can talk about those.
Yeah, I mean, we got a brand new, that debuted during our opening homestand, $2 million video board.
Okay.
A lot bigger, a lot wider, taller than the previous video board, just brighter images. So allows us, the bigger space on the video board allows us to do a lot more. And the last one was good, but just, you know, I was talking to someone earlier this week about how when technology changes, you got to be able to adapt. So with this new building, we were fortunate we were able to also invest $2 million in this video board as well, which is going to really enhance the game day experience.
Right, and again, if people are interested in renting, not the game board, that's part of the stadium, but the pool area, contact the Reading Phillies. Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about some of the players, maybe Jake, on the outfield. You mentioned some of the some of the makeup of the roster, an older, maybe talk a little bit about minor league baseball and the process. I know people might know a little bit more about the draft with football and basketball, but there's quite an extensive minor league personnel department, travels around the world, looks for different players. Maybe you can talk a little bit about how that works at the minor league level and how it affects us here in Reading.
Yeah, for sure. And it's a lot different, of course, than what you're used to when you look at the NBA, the NFL. The Eagles draft a guy, and there's a pretty good chance he's going to be on their roster on opening day, where in baseball, it's a lot different. You rarely see guys get to the big leagues right away or even 1 or 2 years after being drafted. The Phillies' Orion Kerkering is kind of an exception. You draft him in 2022 and he's in the big leagues the next year. But it's a changing demographic, I think is the good way to put it. But really, for to kind of narrow things down, there's a lot of different ways players can enter professional baseball. If you're, you know, from the United States, domestic player, you can, you know, be drafted out of either high school, or if not out of high school, you have to wait 3 years after high school to be drafted again. If you don't get drafted when you're eligible, you can sign as a free agent. And then for players that are not from the United States, that if you're a player from outside the United States and you go to college in the U.S., you're then eligible to be drafted. But a lot of players in especially Latin America and some players overseas in Asia, a lot of them will sign as international free agents. Now, a lot of the players from Latin America, they'll sign at sometimes 16, 17 years old and go through academies down in the Dominican Republic and work their way up. Where a lot of players sometimes overseas, like Japan, for example, you look at a Shohei Ohtani, they play professionally over there first. So a lot of the times they don't sign until they're 24, 25 years old. And then once you are stateside, once you're in the system, there's five different levels. There's AAA, AA, High A, and Single A. And there's also what's called like the Complex League, which is kind of where guys will go like right after they get drafted. And, you know, guys go there and then kind of just progress up through the system. So, you know, here in Reading, we're double A, so a lot of the guys that we have are guys either the Phillies have drafted over the years, signed as free agents, gotten as international free agents who have worked their way up through the system.
I'm interested in, again, I'm a huge baseball fan, as I told you before, and I'm interested in the international aspect of what baseball has become. When I was younger, it was, you know, mostly an American game, and I know that now in the Latin countries as well, but now it's international. You have people coming over, especially from Japan. I know that you have a great relationship with the big leagues, but as far as how you go about deciding how to draft and who to look for and things like that, could you talk a little bit about that? I think that's interesting, to me at least.
Mm-hmm. The Phillies have a really good player development department. Preston Mattingly, who last name might sound familiar, his dad, Don Mattingly, played big league baseball, former manager.
Okay.
Preston Mattingly does a great job running the Phillies player development department, and it is an extensive process. I don't think a lot of people realize, you know, when you're watching the Phillies, there's an extensive process to, you know, find those guys that are coming up through the system. They have a, huge contingent in Latin America that are going to countries like the Dominican Republic, Venezuela, Mexico, trying to find those next crop of players. And a lot of times these are kids that are 15, 16 years old that you're scouting. And sometimes 16-year-olds are getting handed a lot of money because teams see a lot of potential in them, but also understand that you might not see them for 6-7 years, right? Like Johan Rojas, 23 years old, Phillies signed back in 2017 or 2018, okay. And it took him 6 years to get to the big leagues, which is pretty normal, but he's still pretty young, right? So a lot of times it's pretty risky. You're handing a lot of money to someone who's still so young, but you're doing it based off potential. So they have a huge contingent in Latin America. And then, of course, stateside, there's scouts that are all over the country going to different colleges, going to different high schools, trying to figure out who do we want to draft or who do we want to sign. And I also know the Phillies are really trying to start to dip their toe into Asia a bit more, especially Japan. That's been an area where they really have not had a lot of success signing guys. I know they really tried for Yamamoto this past offseason and kind of struck out there, no pun intended. But but I think they're trying to, you know, dip their toes more, especially the Japanese, the Korean baseball circuits, and seeing what they can pull out of there. But it's an extensive process, and there's scouts on scouts all over the world and all over the country trying to figure out the guys. And really the goal is, You're going and signing hundreds of guys per year at the end of the day to really have filled a roster of 28 guys at the big league level, or use minor league guys to trade for guys at the big league level. So, you know, you may only hit on 1% of all the guys that you find, but it's about just trying to find as many high potential guys as possible so you give yourself that best chance to have talent at the big league level.
You talked about the Fightins having an older group, 25 years old, which of course isn't old, but in minor league. What is the progression? Like, do they have a typical progression line that they'd like to have for younger players as they start making it? Maybe you could talk about where the other minor league programs are. I know that, of course, double A's here in Reading, the triple A is up in the Lehigh Valley, mm-hmm. with the Iron Pigs. Maybe you can talk a little bit about the other A and lower level minor league teams as well.
So for sure. So for a lot of our international players, especially the ones from Latin America, when they get signed, they'll usually start at our Dominican Academy. So the Phillies have a couple of teams that play in the Dominican Republic. They'll play about like a 60-game season over the summer. So a lot of those like 16, 17, even 18-year-olds players from Latin America will start off there. And then the Phillies feel like they're ready, they'll come over stateside and eventually go over to like Clearwater. So those guys, and plus the guys that get drafted or signed as undrafted free agents from colleges and high schools in the U.S., they will start in Clearwater, whether for the Florida Complex League Phillies, or some will go to our team in Clearwater, our single A team. And a lot of times, you know, if you're a high school guy, you might start at the complex level. If you're a more experienced college guy, 22, 23 years old, you'll start in single A with Clearwater. And the hope is, you know, for players, they want to progress a level a year, I think, is kind of a reasonable goal for these players. And of course, some fast track and some, you know, just get to the professional level and game speeds up for them, and it's kind of more of a slower progression or something like that. So
the higher draft picks tend to move a little
quicker. Absolutely. So, yeah, so you look at like a Mick Abel and Andrew Painter, two guys that kind of progress fairly quickly, where a guy who might be a 15th or 16th round pick might be a slower progression. And once you get through Clearwater, you come up north, you go to Jersey Shore, which is in Lakewood, New Jersey, a couple of hours from us here in Reading. That's our high A team. Then, of course, you come to Reading. Hour from here, you go to AAA Lehigh Valley. And then from there, hour down the turnpike, and you're in Philadelphia.
Yeah, hopefully that's the goal. Sheila, let's go back to talking about, I'm interested in learning about the process that we go through here. Let's talk about some of the exciting things that are happening in 2024 at the stadium. And I know you mentioned a whole bunch of things. Is there any, do they have special things for the holidays, for the Memorial Day weekend, for the 4th of July, those kind of things that are coming? Is there anything that you would like to mention with regards to some of the holidays or some of the special events that are happening throughout this season?
Sure. So we have, it's kind of unique going into summer in that we have to work around, the baseball schedule first and foremost. But we're excited to go in a different direction with regards to possibly creating some holiday events, especially in and around the December time of year. I believe the team is actually home 4th of July. So that would be a date that we would be able to actually host a group in the event center. What's really neat about that space, whether game day or non-game day, but especially on a game day where there's fireworks, the entire large event space actually has its own private veranda that lines the home run wall. So whether you're out there on a game day, you have the opportunity to actually catch a home run. Best seat in the house for fireworks, that's for sure. Yeah, you do, for sure. But even for non-game day events, it's a really unique space that the doors that actually connect to that, it's a 9-foot veranda. They're 180 center swing, so that it actually can transform that space into an open air function area for events when we have nice days like we are currently going into mm-hmm. right now, which we love. And then just kind of using the space to kind of make it be whatever, you know, direction that we want it to kind of go into. So we're still kind of ironing out those right. details as far as what we're going to use it for. But what's nice is the space itself can be utilized by, on a game day, an entire group for an exclusive booking. Or we do have the ability to almost create open air suites or pods that groups okay. can use so that we can have multiple groups celebrating birthdays or special events or retirement parties on a game day. And just really bring a different level to the stadium.
Sounds like a lot of fun, a lot of yeah. opportunities. And I know there's other things going on in conjunction with the game. Either of you can chat about. I know that there's lots of fireworks, yes. a lot of special events. The mascots. Why don't we throw that out? Let's talk about. We have a few minutes left in the show. Let's talk about maybe. I know there's a lot of fireworks. I used to live not too far away from the stadium, so I used to watch fireworks a lot, and it was great. We loved it. So let's talk maybe a little bit about, I know they have them every weekend, or what are some of the other events that we can look forward to this coming season?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, fireworks-wise, pretty much starting our next homestand last week of April, at least Friday, Saturday, there's going to be some semblance of fireworks. Thursdays and even some Wednesdays, once you get into the summers, there'll be fireworks as well. But yeah, a lot of exciting giveaways, a lot of exciting bobbleheads. Johan Rojas, Ryan Kirkering, Alec Boehm, Aaron Nola. So lots of really exciting bobbleheads this year, great giveaways, and it should be a good summer. And I mean, like, every game is some sort of a party, as we always kind of like to put it. There's a pregame concert, there's a happy hour at the Yuengling Hometown Tap Room. And then once we get into like our warmer months, May, June, July, August, a lot of Friday and Saturday nights after our fireworks shows, we have a post-game concert for about an hour after the game, so anybody, you know, staff or fans can hang out and get a drink from our tap room or just listen to some live music. So it's kind of like a party pre-game and post-game almost every night.
And maybe the next Taylor Swift will be singing the national anthem at one of the nights. I know you talked about music. I know, and I've been there for those and the bar area. I mean, what else? I mean, is there anything else you want to mention that we have to look forward to with regards to the upcoming season, either from Jake, either from your perspective or for Sheila?
Yeah, I mean, video board's the big thing. Of course, the event center we talked about. Concession-wise, a couple of new things, nothing too much. Spicy chicken sandwich on the concession okay. menu this year. A couple of new slushy flavors. I know we have an espresso martini slushy flavor this year. I might have to give that one a try myself. It yeah. sounds really good.
Might have to check that out.
Some kids slushy flavors. Outside of that, like, obviously there's a lot of new additions, but I think the one thing that makes us really special is that we kind of really stick to our roots, right? Yeah. Like, the pepperoni's still free on the pizza. The hot dog is still served on a paper napkin. The, you know, grandstand, the seating bowl is the same. Obviously, the seats have been upgraded over 75 years, but it's like the same layout of the stadium since 1951. It's all the right. same hallways that Mike Schmidt and Darren Dalton and Ryan Howard and Jimmy Rollins all walk through. So that's the cool part, is that we have the event center, which is like the new age, the modern era. But there's still, and the event center shows this too, and the rest of the stadium has as well, like, there's still always a reminder of where we came from, our past, our history, because even as we continue to improve and make these upgrades, we still don't want to forget about our history, because that's really important to us.
It's great. As you walk through where the facility, the concessions are underneath, there's a lot of history. There's, as you mentioned, people like Mike Schmidt and Darren Dalton and Larry Bowen and Lisinski and all the great Phils. There's even a thing, a friend of mine, Rocky Colavito, who played way back before they were even affiliated with the Phils. They were affiliated with the Indians, and Rocky Colavito, who's a local legend here, played for Cleveland and Detroit, is on that wall as well. And I think that's the uniqueness. Minor league baseball is wonderful because you can, it's reasonably priced, parking is free, and you can bring your family. And I think there's so many opportunities to do that, and I just really look forward to attending a lot of the games. So with the last minute that we have, we can just fill in with whatever you think we should do. I just want to appreciate and thank you for coming out today and talking about the exciting things that are going to be happening this summer at the stadium with regards to the Fightin Phils. So Sheila and Jake, thank you so much. If you have anything else you want to add, we'll take that right now, and then we'll conclude our meeting, our show. Awesome. Just how to contact. Let's just end with maybe how to get a hold of you again and get a hold of the Reading Phils and the events that are happening there for the season.
Sure. Yeah. If you go to our website, we do have an request for proposal link that will connect you to the Redner's Event Center directly. My email is on there, my phone number, and we would love to connect and see what events you have in mind and see where, you know, we might be able to host you in this new space. We're super excited about it. Not only for the large space, but I think the components of having a clubhouse, actually two clubhouses that can convert to meeting space is incredibly exciting, and we're really excited to bring it to Berks.
Great, and we look forward to that. And Jake, we look forward to you announcing the games this year and bringing all the excitement of the Reading Fightin Phils to all of us here at Berks County and the surrounding community. So thanks again for coming. That's our show for this month. This has been County Connections. I'm your County Commissioner, Dante Santoni. Thank you for watching.